So we will now, after having seen different approaches of value building in the customer relationship marketing approach, so namely brand characteristics, intrinsic characteristics of the brand, service quality and service recovery, value alignment and personalization, loyalty or relationship programs. We will now see customer engagement process, which can be done at two levels, so product engagement process and in the communication engagement. So we will see now consumer empowerment and customerization. We've seen, first of all, that customer engagement is the highest level of the relationship marketing paradigm, which means that customers are cognitively engaged, affectively engaged, and behaviorally engaged. So it's the highest level of loyalty. If you can. Customers individually, and this is also related to technologies. So customers become more empowered because they have more voice and more possibilities to interact with the brand. But this is only possible through technologies and also through relationship. And therefore, before customer engage, it's important to have loyal customer. And not only behavioral loyalty customer, because we have seen it's a spurious loyalty, but we need attitudinal loyal customer, which means that they have affective feelings, so emotions, attachment to the brand. Engagement is correlated to brand attachment, so it's important to have customers who like the brand, but clearly not all brands have the potential to be liked. If we take the example of fast-moving consumer goods, most brands do not have attention. Only more brands in emotional contexts, for example, baby products, where we can. That is why Ben Gamble with the Pampers Club have the potential to establish a relationship marketing, because we are clearly in an emotional product category where parents want the best for the children. So a discourse, a relationship with parents is imaginable. It's the same for Nestle, baby food. It is the same for cosmetics, but toilet paper, nobody wants to have a relationship with the toilet paper. So clearly there are limits. This context related, and there are contexts where it fits better, and context where it fits less or not at all. And it's the same for customer engagement. In other categories, there might be a really engagement. And again, take the example of Procter & Gamble. They might succeed to engage customers because the product is highly involving. It's with a high risk perceived, and mothers are quite attached to Pampers. Or if you take the example of Nivea, which has a very high brand awareness, this is also one brand that to which people, above all in Germany, attached, because it's a grandmother's brand, which was used already by grandmothers, and the capital and the awareness was transmitted from the grandmother to the mother to the children, from Nutella. It's also one of these brands where you can imagine brand attachment. Okay, so consumers are actually, it's related to technologies, so I come back to my initial idea. It's also related to consumers who are more ready now to participate. They're more informed due to information systems, the internet. So they're informed about good things about the brand, but also about bad things. They're organized in networks. Now our social capital goes beyond frontiers through social media to get information, but also to transmit information to other members. And this is clearly used in the customer engagement process. There are actually resistant or active customers who might become militants for the brand, but they might also become enemies of the brand. So it's important to engage them, but in the positive way, so that they're doing positive word of mouth. So they're increasing and engaging in an active dialogue with the brands. So they want to co-create and create value. So summary, we are moving from a manufacturer active paradigm to a user or consumer active paradigm where the consumer becomes active. So these consumers are actually engaged in networks. So the most part of co-creation is done in networks, what we call crowdsourcing. Why it is important in CRM? Because it enables the firm to make personalization. Because the customer co-creates the product exactly in the manner he or she wants to have it, and the firm produces it in this way. And so co-creation brings also more personalization. Firms are quite similar, because co-creation or empowerment is also called customization. Various personalization, as you have seen, so when the customer personalizes, it's called customization. Right? So you have customization versus customerization. Customization, co-creation, various customization is personalization done by the customer. A lot of brands are engaging in that, including Airbus, BMW, IT, L'Oreal, Nivea, Procter & Gamble, all the big brands are now doing. And so all firms are actually investing in that, because who better can create products for other consumers than customers? Because they know what they want, and so they can transmit and create better than research and development departments. Instead of having this kind of closed innovation, it is open innovation, and ideas can come from inside R&D and from outside from the customers. And more now, products are now created by customers, and these products have higher probabilities to succeed. That is why it's important in the CRM process to engage customers, to create thrilled customer journeys through product engaging co-creation strategies and communication engaging co-creation strategies. And this is done with new media, right? Electronic media. Key measures are always the same. You measure repeat purchase, but also lifetime value, and you measure referrals in customer engaging communication.